You were able to join us today. I just want to mention to you that if you are a guest with us today, that in front of you in a pocket, probably in the chair or ahead of you, is a connections card. We have several people holding them up. That's what they look like. And we would just invite you, if you don't mind, to fill out one of those connections cards and give us whatever information you're willing to give us about yourself. You'll also see the entire church knows this, that there's a place for prayer requests. And if you would like for me to pray for something for you this week, each day, God helping me, I'm here in this room and I'm praying for you. And so when I have these requests, I bring them in and I pray over them. I'm happy to do that. It's part of my ministry for you. If there's something confidential that you want to write, what I would suggest that you do is write it on the card, and there is a little box in the hallway as you're headed out for these connection cards. You can slip it in there. I'm the one that takes it out. That then your prayer request remains confidential between you and I and the Lord. If it's not so confidential and you just want to slip it in our offering plate as it goes by, you're more than welcome to do that. But I wanted to just ask you to, if you would, fill that out. And if you are new to us especially, thank you for being here. Just fill it out so we know who is here. We'll try not to bug you too badly. We don't do that. We don't harass anybody. So we just would love to know that you were here. I ask you to make sure you get a bulletin, because in your bulletin there are several announcements. I want to take a few moments to just highlight next weekend. On Saturday the 15th, we are going out as a church and we are giving away cookies. We're going into neighborhoods and we're going to tap on doors and just gift people with cookies. And I just want to brag on you as a church. We kind of told you last week that we were collecting funds to pay a dollar. It cost us a dollar a tin to give away these cookies. And we had a goal of 600 and we surpassed that goal. And we'll be going, and so thank you to all of you who were generous and who helped us provide for that financially. It isn't a line item in our budget, so we relied on you, and we thank you so much for your willingness to contribute to that. And as I said, we now will need a team of us to go out on Saturday morning. And if you would like to come, we'd love for you to join us. Come on out here on Saturday, and then we'll meet somewhere around, 9 o'clock, Betsy? 8:30. That's what I meant to say. Thank you, Mark. About 8:30 here, we would love for you to come. And even if you don't get to come here regularly, this sounds like something you'd like to do. It's fun. We had a great time. It's so much fun to hand somebody something and with no strings attached and watch their face. I love it. Just Merry Christmas to you from the Gospel Chapel. And let them have it. And they just, really? That's all? Yeah, let them have it, right? So, but it opened up a lot of opportunities for me to talk to people and introduce myself to the community. We're doing it again this week. So that's an important part of what we are in trying to tell people about who we are and that we love them. They matter to us. There are other announcements that are listed here. They're important, so please read them if you will. I don't want to bore you by reading them. I'm asking you to do something for me. You will see cards like this out in the cafe, okay? And here's what I'm asking you to do. This is a postcard size card so that you can invite somebody in your life to come out and be part of our Christmas Advent season. This entire season, it's already begun, but there's a lot going on. This sums it up pretty well for you. And this also tells about our Christmas Eve service, which we have every year. It's 1 hour. 1 hour long, and I keep it at max because I know you have family things, but we would love for you to invite people to come. I had somebody tell me, well, we're going to take up about 2 rows with our friends and our family that we've invited for Christmas Eve. And I said, yes, and I want you to do the same, okay? Bring people out. Especially if you know of anybody who's not used to going to church. It's a great service for them to come, a wonderful traditional way to enjoy some Christmas music and just to enjoy what Christmas is all about. Well, you've sat here long enough staring at this face, and we are going to step away, and we will have a traditional thing happen here on our platform as each year we have an Advent wreath that we have a reading for, and we have it lit. So as they come forward to do that, I'm going to pray very briefly that the Holy Spirit will bless us and that God will inspire us as we worship him. Will you join me in prayer? Thank you, Father, for the privilege of being in your house today. We have come, Lord, to have an encounter with you. We have come because you are far greater than we can think or imagine, and we love you. We ask you to bless us and minister to us, Lord, today, and help us, O God, as we progress. Touch us, Lord, where only you can touch us, and help us, O God, to obey and to hear your word and to be inspired by your spirit, Lord. Fill us and bless us in Jesus' name. Amen.
When the Heavenly Father when the Heavenly Host appeared with the angel announcing the birth of Jesus, they praise God, saying, "Glory to the in the highest, and on earth peace to men whom his favor rests." The prophet Isaiah was instructed to proclaim some of the titles of the Messiah, one of which was Prince of Peace. Jesus said to his disciples, this is John 14, verse 27, "Peace I leave with you, my heart speaks. Peace I give you, I do not want to give you as the world gives. Do not let my heart be troubled. Do not be afraid." Today we light the candle of peace. In the gifting the world with his only son, God gave us peace. It is a priceless gift. Peace is absence of anxiety and worry. When one is at peace, one does not have a troubled heart. There is rest and calm. There is a quiet and confidence and no fear. The peace that Jesus provides is the greatest peace of all, peace between a person and God. Hear these words from Ephesians 2. "Therefore, remember that formerly you are the Gentiles by birth and called uncircumcised by those who call themselves the circumcision, which is done in the body by human hands. Remember that all the time you were separate from Christ, excluded from citizenship in Israel and foreigners and to the covenants of the promise, without hope and without God in the world. But now in Christ Jesus, you once were far away, have been brought near by the blood of Christ.
For he himself is our peace, who has made the two groups one, has destroyed the barrier, the dividing wall of hostility, by setting aside his flesh, the law with its commands and regulations. His purpose was to create in himself one new humanity out of the two, thus making peace, and in one body to be reconciled both of them to God through the cross, by which to put under death hostility. He came and preached peace to who were far and peace to those who were near. For through him we both have access to the Father by one
Consequently, you are no longer foreigners and strangers, but fellow citizens with God's people and also members of the household, built on the foundation of the apostles and prophets, with Jesus Christ himself as the chief cornerstone. The peace that Jesus gives truly passes all our understandings. Philippians 4:7. Let us pray. Father, we praise you for the gifting the world with your Holy Son, who gives the priceless gift of peace with you. Thank you for our Savior. We pray in his mighty name. Amen.
Amen. If you'll please rise as we go to a time of worship this morning. blessed be your name. And blessed be your name.
When I'm found in the desert place, though I walk through the wilderness, blessed be your name. Every blessing you pour out, I'll turn back to praise. When the darkness closes in, Lord, still I will say, blessed be the name of the Lord.
Your mighty words display
as beautiful as you. And you've opened my eyes to your wonders anew. You captured my heart with this love. Because nothing on earth is as beautiful as you. Beautiful one.
Doesn't want to hear me pray up here. He wants to hear everybody pray. So let's just pray on those heaven's gates. Let's just pray whatever I'm asking Jesus, that let's just pray it into existence. Heavenly Father, Lord, we thank you, Lord, that you are a God that is so good. That God that you are, the great I am. There is just no other way to explain you, but you are the God of the universe, the God who created everything, God who created us and loves us so much that, Lord, even when we fall short, that God, that you still love us the same. God, you love us the same whether we do a whole lot for you or we don't, Lord, that your love is always the same for us. We thank you for that, Lord. That, Lord, we don't have to worry about, do you love us? Because, God, your word says you do. God, that you love us so much that you sent your son into this world, which we celebrate this season right now, Jesus' birth. God, thank you for sending your son. Jesus, thank you for coming here and willingly giving up your life for us so that we can have eternal life with you. That, God, that we have that hope, and not hoping we can go to heaven, but hoping, knowing that we are, that is our hope, that we are going to heaven if we're a believer. So thank you, Lord, that everybody has that same opportunity to believe in you and trust you for their salvation. That, Lord, you don't favor one or another, that God is open to each and every person. Thank you, Lord, that you treat us all equal. God, that we don't have to be favored above anybody else or do more than somebody else. But God, your love for us is just so great. And God, we come here today to praise you, to worship you. God, to give you our hearts, to give you our lives. Lord, thank you that, Lord, that when we give our life to you, Lord, that you come in and you take control. Lord, that's what you want. You want to not control us, Lord, but you want us to allow you to be in control of our lives. That, God, that we would give up our life for you. And God, what a peace that you give us in return, Lord. What just having that in our life, Lord, having you in our life, Lord, is greater than anything that we could ever get, is to have that relationship with you and that peace that you give us, to know that you are in control, that you care for us and love us so dearly. God, that you provide. Thank you for providing us with this building here, Lord. Thank you that we could worship here in the warmth today, Lord. Thank you for each and every person that you have brought here today, Lord, that we could worship together. We could honor you with our praises, with our lips, with our actions. God, I thank you for our pastor, Lord, that you have put in charge here, Lord. I pray for him, Lord, you'd continually to be with him, Lord, and anoint this service, Lord. Anoint him, Lord, to preach your word today, God. Let him preach every word you want him to speak. Let him not hold back one word that you want him to speak today, Lord. God, we thank you for him. We thank you for his family, Lord. God, I thank you, Lord, that we could be here today and just worship. That we could stand in awe of you, Lord, of all your goodness. God, you are amazing. And we praise you and we thank you. And we love you today, Lord. God, I pray for those, Lord, who came in today with a heavy burden, Lord, that God, that they would just give it to you and say, God, I'm just going to trust you with it today. And they could have that peace to know, Lord, that you take it and, God, you'll do with what is best in the best interest for that person, Lord. That, God, we don't have to figure it all out. That, Lord, you already know our lives and what's ahead of us. God, thank you for taking those burdens, that we could just give them to you, that we don't have to sit and worry about everything. Thank you, Lord, that you are a God who does that for us. Thank you, Lord, for the ministries that you have set before us as well, Lord, that we could do your work, that we could share the gospel, especially this season, Lord. I believe you give us so many opportunities this season that we could share the gospel, because that's what Christmas is. It's about the good news of Jesus Christ. Thank you for that, Lord. Give us the boldness to share that with our families this Christmas, our friends, our co-workers, that we would be bold and be able to share what the importance of Christmas is for us. God, thank you for all you do and all that you are. Thank you that you want a personal relationship with each and every one of us. We praise you. We love you. In Jesus' name we pray. This time the ushers would come forward. It's time for us to receive your tithes and offerings.
So you come forward, we're going to pray for the offering. Heavenly Father, we thank you that what you have given us, that what you entrust us with, and God, you're just asking for a portion back. God, let us honor you with our giving today. Let it please you, Lord. Let it put a smile on your face as we give generously, just like your word says. God, help us to take that step if we never took it today, Lord, to give to you what you're asking us to give, that we don't hold back nothing, but give you all that you want. Give it all to you. In the name of Jesus, I pray.
Rain is wind and mercy.
comedian Jimmy Kimmel asked parents to prank their kids by pretending to give them terrible Christmas presents and videotaping the results. Let's just say they really got into the spirit. They sent Kimmel so many videos, he's made a sequel. Take a look.
What is it?
Really, taco seasoning.
Yeah, don't you like tacos?
I'm only six, I can't make it.
Yeah, you can.
Hold it open so I can see it. Hold it up.
Damn.
Oh, it's a 3DS.
And a
Mr. Potato Head. That's what she wanted for Christmas.
No, a 3DS game. This is nothing without we get this up network. It's so fair that you give us the award. I'm going to deserve it away.
That's what she wanted, Sean.
You gave me the board to stop. And you guys are studying the worst.
Wow. It's cruel, but it's funny. I got to admit. I like the kid who just appreciated the potato. You know, sometimes it's nice.
Ever received a gift that you really didn't like a whole lot? Has anybody ever gifted you with something and you thought, you know, maybe you were a little younger and you had a reaction, something like this? In my case, when I was a young boy, probably between the ages of 5 and 12, every year I had an aunt who was kind enough and generous enough each Christmas to give me clothes, which, by the way, I truly needed. A lot of times I received a year's supply of, let's just say, socks and t-shirts, okay? I just got a year's supply, and it was something that I may have needed, but a 5 to 12-year-old boy doesn't process that the same way, and I would have rather have had something that I could play with. I do want to report to you that I never acted that way. I never cried. I never threw a tantrum or acted ungrateful in any way. I would have paid for it if I had. And so instead, I always got up and I walked up to my aunt and gave her a big hug and thanked her for her thoughtful gift. In all honesty, my aunt gave me a gift that I really needed, in spite of the fact that it wasn't exactly what I wanted. And it was a gift that lasted a lot longer than the toys a lot of times that I was hoping to get. As an adult now, looking back, I can certainly appreciate a whole lot more what my aunt was trying to do for our family and for me. My parents couldn't afford the clothes, and so she was sweet enough every year to make sure that I had nice clothes to wear. I'll just say it that way. So let's look today in Isaiah chapter 53. Isaiah chapter 53. After laying this foundation, you're probably wondering, where in the world will Pastor go this time? But before we read this, I plead with you to really focus hard on what these words are saying. Don't gloss over these. Look at them intentionally. Pay attention to what these words are saying. Isaiah 53, beginning with verse 1. Who has believed our message, and to whom has the Lord been revealed? He grew up before him like a tender shoot, like a root out of dry ground. And he had no beauty or majesty to attract us to him. Nothing in his appearance that we should desire him. He was despised and rejected by mankind. A man of suffering and familiar with pain. Like one from whom people hide their faces, he was despised. And we held him in low esteem. Surely he took up our pain and bore our suffering, yet we consider him punished by God, stricken by him and afflicted. But he was pierced for our transgressions, and he was crushed for our iniquities. The punishment that brought us peace was on him, and by his wounds we are healed. Glory to God. This is week two of our series, Gifted. Last week we were challenged to examine our mindset. I asked you to think a little bit about the way you think. Okay, and I'll continue in that vein a little bit this week. But if you'll recall, I asked you to deliberately say to yourself, it's not my birthday. It's not about me, except it is about me. I asked you to think on those in that vein of thought. And today I pose it to you again. I ask you to think that way. I have posed this scenario to you here as a church before, but this is the best way I want to segue into my remarks today. I would like for you to suppose that you were tasked with orchestrating how God's Son would come from heaven to earth. I would like you to think about how you would do it without any knowledge. Just pretend you don't know how it was done. How would you have the Son of God show up? I don't know how many of us would have had him be a baby. I'm telling you, if I can be openly honest about it, if I were tasked with this job, I wouldn't have picked him becoming a baby. I would have picked him staying exactly who he is, the Lord of glory. I would have split the sky wide open, and every angel and every heavenly host would accompany him in a procession as he came from glory to the earth. I would have the whole world see Jesus in his power, in his glory, and I would have him come with the trumpets blasting, with angels shouting, look who it is. This is the Son of God coming to you. God is coming to the earth. Oh, I would have him coming in all kinds of majesty and pomp, and tell you the truth, folks, he would never be in a manger, and he would never be in a stable. Because he's the King of Kings, he would either come to the temple of the Lord or he'd live in a palace. I'm telling you how I would orchestrate it. I would have so much fanfare, and I think I would have Jesus coming looking impressive, powerful, kingly, handsome. I'm certain it would have looked very different than the way it actually happened. Can I tell you, I'm so glad God didn't task me with bringing the Son of God to the world. I'm so glad for the way that he chose to do it. The Bible reveals something else about this indescribable gift that God gave to the world. And this is what we read this morning, and this is where I wanted to go. Surprisingly, I'll just back up. I don't think very many of us would have come close to the way it really happened. I think we would have done it a little closer to the way I was orchestrating it. But surprisingly, Jesus was not many people's idea of the Son of God. The way he came, the parents, his earthly parents, the town he came from, the family he was part of, none of that was anybody's idea of what the Messiah should look like. He didn't do or say, as he lived and as he ministered, what many people believed the Messiah should do and say. It didn't look right to them. Look at what our scripture tells us about Jesus. It says he grew up before him, speaking of God. He grew up before him like a tender shoot and like a root out of dry ground. He had no beauty or majesty to attract us to him. Nothing in his appearance that we should desire him. These are astounding words. He was despised and rejected by mankind. A man of suffering, familiar with pain, like one from whom people hide their faces. He was despised, and we held him in low esteem. This confirms for me a struggle I have. I have a hard time understanding this, to be honest with you. But this is the reality of life on planet Earth today. A large majority of people have not and will not receive God's gift. They reject him. Most people will treat God's gift like young children would treat a gift of socks and underwear. Many are outright offended, and they despise the gift, and they reject the gift. They look at it as not desirable. Most people will fail to comprehend him. They hide their faces from him, and they deny his claims about himself. He is held in low esteem by most of the world. Can I be honest with you and say to you that for me, it's mind-boggling and heartbreaking. I so very much want to do my part to help people understand who Jesus is. It's why I'm so passionate about this and why I hardly ever give you guys a break on this. I'm constantly in your face saying, we have to tell people. We have to let them understand. We have to invite people. We have to try to get to them the value of the gift, this indescribable gift that's too wonderful for words that God gave to the world. It's why I challenge you all the time. We need to tell people about him. Because what I'm convinced of is most people in the world don't even comprehend how wonderful he is. It is like receiving a gift that we really need, but we don't want. And so I'm constantly before you talking about this, and I know I do it, and I don't know what else to say. You probably have to fire me to stop me from doing this, because this is how valuable Jesus is to me. Frankly, most people in this world ultimately do not want God's indescribable gift. And it's surprising. They never do receive it. And because of that, they who clearly communicated all of their lives often that they do not want Jesus end up sowing what they reap, an eternity without him. They tell him, leave me alone long enough, where at some point they enter into eternity and they get their wish. They're turned away. And the Bible says they're cast out into outer darkness where there is weeping and gnashing of teeth. A horrible place. As I sat in my office writing this sermon and writing what I just said to you, I thought to myself, man, this is un-Christmas. This is not a Christmas-sounding message. And the season is supposed to be one of good cheer and goodwill. It's the season of good news, Pastor Ken. And for all people, all I can say to you is, despite the fact that this sermon has taken on such a serious tone, and despite the fact that there may be some who don't like what I just said, it is truth. And I said it because it needs to be said. It is a catastrophic thing when a person despises and rejects the gift of God. It is horrific when any person goes into eternity without Jesus. Let's please not lose sight of the fact that while Jesus may not be the gift most humanity wanted, he is the gift that all humanity needed. He is that gift. In giving Jesus to humanity, in giving Jesus the way that he gave him, God may not have given humanity what we would have chosen, but his gift was perfect and far better for us. It is the gift we need. So I want to go on record today and emphatically say to you, I am so grateful for God's gift to the earth, the way he was given and the one who was given. He is exactly who I needed. And thanks be to God for his indescribable gift. I think that part of today's message will have a direct tie to some of what I said to you last week. Oh, how important it is for us to think correctly when we are looking into the Word of God and when we are considering what this says about Jesus. So I'm going to make some comments starting again there for you. I've laid a foundation down, and I want to again ask you to, I want to kind of address the way that we think. And I want to ask you to consider what our response should be when the Father has given us Jesus. Okay, that's a good response. I like it. Where are you? There you are, Sharon. She's hiding behind Bill this time. But yes, that's a good response. But what should our response be? What should we do in light of the fact that we have been given Jesus in the way that he gave him? Even if many in the world don't feel like he is what they wanted, what should our response be? I think that would be a fair question. I would suggest to you, let's love the giver. Let's love the giver. God gave Jesus because. There's a because there. He is not obligated to give us anything. Do we understand that? God didn't need to give me a thing. He gave me Jesus because. God had already given so much to humanity. We exist because of him. Every single day, the sunlight and the water and the air and the land you walk on, the gravity that keeps you from flying out into space, and all of the health that you have in your bodies and the capacities that you have. Every day, you are gifted every single day from God. He blesses you every single day with so many things. He puts wonderful people in your life like me. He does great things for you. God every day gifts you. And I'm joking about the wonderful people thing, okay? But, well, person. But God gifts us with so many things. He's on no hook. He's not obligated to bless us. But the fact is, God gave Jesus because he wanted to. And he wanted to give Jesus to the world because he loves us so much. God so loved the world that he gave his one and only son, his only begotten son. And he wanted to because he loves us, and he loves us because he is good. God gave Jesus because through Jesus, human beings have the ability to have a relationship with their creator. It's amazing. All of this was about relationship. All of this was about God coming to us and loving on us when we didn't deserve it or earn it, where we had no value in and of ourselves other than what God held, and it was so much value he gave Jesus up for it. Part of why I'm so bewildered by the fact that most people reject Jesus is because of who the giver is. I'm astounded by him. How could we possibly measure the level of this respect that comes from despising and rejecting God's son? Shouldn't humanity be moved by the fact that God gave us anything at all, let alone his son? Shouldn't we be overcome with gratitude? Can I just ask you something? When you give a gift, I would dare to say that most of us do not give gifts out of obligation. You know why Darlene gives me gifts? Because she loves me. And honestly, for me, okay, the fact that she went through the trouble of trying to figure out something I would enjoy that would make my life a little better, a little bit nicer, or have something nice that she wants to give to me, the fact that she thought through it, the fact that she personally wrapped it up and gave it to me, you know why I love that gift? It's because she gave it to me. It's because it's an I love you. That's why. It's because when Darlene gives me a gift, it's saying, I thought of you, and I love you. Folks, God gave Jesus. And I don't know of any greater way that he could say to you personally, I love you. Here's my son. I love you, and I give you my son. Oh, we should love the giver. We should see the heart behind the Heavenly Father giving us his son in the way that he brought him to the world. He brought him to the world in a way that anybody can relate to him. The poorest of the poor can relate to Jesus. The homeless can relate to Jesus. He came in humility. He came without the splendor and the majesty that I would have wanted him to come. Are you thinking with me that he didn't have, that there was ever a time before he was born that he didn't have majesty and splendor and didn't look glorious? I know he did. He dropped it all. He shed it all. And he became one of us. And he became the lowliest among us. He let himself be born in a stable to some lowly people. And he lived a very ordinary looking life. Why? Because he wanted everybody to be able to approach him. There's nobody so, quote, low in this station of life that they can't be accepted by and loved by Jesus Christ. Wow. I love the giver for that. I love that the giver would let his son. Man, would you do this for anybody? Would you give your child and say, I'm going to impoverish you? I'm going to stick you on earth, and you're going to be a man of sorrows, and you're going to have no pain. Would you do that for I can't even imagine this. So I love the giver. I love him for what he did. I love God for loving us so much. So here we are again with me urging you to love God. Like I haven't done that before. But why shouldn't we? Why wouldn't we love him? I'm pretty certain that most of us here today are aware enough to know that when somebody gives us a gift for Christmas, they have done so out of love. They have done so because they wanted to. And most of us here today are self-aware enough that no matter what is under the wrapping, it could be anything. The fact that somebody did that for us mattered, and we would love them. The best part of the gift is the giver. So Jesus did not come in the way that we thought he should. Did not have the appearance we had scripted him to have. He didn't do and say everything that we would have expected him to do and say. We meaning humanity. He wasn't what people expected, but he was given. I truly believe that the best part of the gift of Christ is the giver. Jesus came from God. Jesus was God. And he loves us deeply. Jesus is God. And God actually gave himself. He came in a way that every one of us could have a relationship with him. Wow. What a wonderful thing. Secondly, in our response to all of this, I would suggest to us to trust the giver. Trust him. So the giver is God. Is God good? Is God kind? Is he generous? Is our God wise? Is he wise enough to know what gift to give to this world? Is he wise enough to know what you need and give it to you? Earlier, I told you how very grateful I feel to the Father for giving Jesus. And here is a large part as to why I feel so much of this in my heart. It's in our scripture, verses 4 and 5, talking of Jesus. Surely he took up our pain, and he bore our suffering. Yet we considered him punished by God, stricken by him, and afflicted. But he was pierced for our transgressions. He was crushed for our iniquities. The punishment that brought us peace was on him. And by his wounds, we were healed. What I want to remind you of today is something that a little bit is before you today in a visual way. This cradle, representing also the manger, is directly in line with the cross. And I want to remind you that God gave you the cross. He gave Jesus knowing what was ahead of him from the cradle, if you will, to the cross, from the manger to the cross. God gave Jesus knowing that Jesus would be one who would suffer. His wounds would heal me. He would be pierced because of me. That's why I love the giver so much. And that's why I appreciate him. And that's why I'm so grateful. It was because he took what I deserve and he gave me, he exchanged my life for his on the cross. I needed to be on the cross. I deserved it. I punished. I should have been punished. I should have been crucified, an old songwriter wrote. It should have been me. But instead, Christ hung on the cross. And the reason I love the gift so much is because Jesus took my punishment for me, took what I deserve, and he exchanged his life for mine. I get the glory. I get to be with him in glory. I get the blessings of belonging to God. I get treated like a son of God. I get adopted into his family, all because of this gift. I'm saying to you, brothers and sisters, we not only need to love the giver, we need to trust him. God gave us a cross. And we had no clue when he came into the world that this was what was ahead of him. What an amazing thought that Jesus did these things for us. What mercy that God knew his son would go to the cross and that because he did so, he would be considered stricken by God in our eyes and that he would be despised. What an amazing thing that God was good enough and kind enough and generous enough and wise enough to have Jesus pierced for our transgressions and crushed for our iniquities. All because God knew that the punishment we deserved, Jesus received. It brought us peace and his wounds healed us. Why would we be in the least bit hesitant to trust a God like that? Honestly, why do we struggle with it? It bewilders me that so many won't trust God and won't trust the gift. It bewilders me that so many despise the gift, so many reject Jesus. What could be more egregious and outrageous than that? You know, the thought occurred to me after I wrapped up this message, the thought occurred to me that God knew when he gave Jesus that most of humanity would reject him. You want to know why he gave him anyway? Because you believe. He did it for you. Because you trust the giver and you love the giver. And you were enough. You were enough for Jesus to go through all that he went through. And although most of the world would turn away and reject him, you didn't. And because you don't, he gave Jesus to the world. I don't know what that does to you, but it melts my heart with gratitude. I don't know how to best describe to you what he deserves from me. I don't even know how to praise him enough in the proper way. I don't know if I should go charismatic on you and just start running around and jumping up and down and pray. I don't know what the right way to do it. I'm joking around a little bit. I just want him to know I really appreciate it. And I think the best thing that I can do is receive the gift. Now, many of you are sitting here probably thinking, yeah, Pastor Ken, my goodness, yeah, that's preaching 101. Yes, it is. But as silly as this sounds, God offered Christ to us. He gave Jesus to us with the full intention that we would receive him. What good is giving a gift to somebody who won't even take it? What good is that gift to them if they won't receive it? Maybe Jesus isn't who we expect him to be. Maybe he's not who you expect him to be. Maybe Jesus' teachings aren't what you had hoped that they would be. Perhaps in complete honesty, you feel let down by the Lord. You may question his judgment and his love. Jesus may have turned out to be very different from your idea of who he is, or maybe very different from who you were taught he is. Maybe some of the things that he did and said challenges your belief and sensibilities today. Maybe you feel like Jesus is far too uncompromising and far too unbending in his standards. Perhaps you struggle with what he allows to happen in this world. And frankly, there are a lot of reasons why so many people do not receive and embrace God's gift, God's only Son. There are only a few things greater that a human being can express to God than faith. I think love is one of them. I think he wants our love. But folks, faith is the currency of the kingdom of God. It's the currency that we need. This cycles back to the two other things I'm urging you to do, to love the giver and to trust the giver. I believe that what I'm talking about here today is why Hebrews 11 verse 6 tells us that without faith in him, it's impossible to please him. So if in your mind you can't have confidence that God is a good God, you're going to struggle at this, at receiving from God. If you can't trust that God is good enough to give you what you need the most, even if it looks different and feels different than you expected, then you don't have enough. You're going to struggle because you need the faith to believe in God's heart. You need the faith to know that God would not harm you unintentionally. God would never do something that was unkind to you. He is perfect and flawless. And you need to be able to grasp that with your heart and with your mind. You need to understand that God is a good God, perfect in all of his ways. And so maybe you do struggle a little bit with what this gift looks like and how he has expressed himself. But without faith, it is impossible to please God. One simply cannot receive the gift of Christ without faith. Jesus was once asked by a group of his countrymen and compatriots, what must we do to do the work that God requires? And Jesus' reply is one that sticks in my heart. I love this reply. Jesus said, the work of God is this, to believe in the one he has sent. John chapter 6, verses 28 and 29. Are you willing to receive Jesus on God's terms? You can come forward, Andrew. On the giver's terms, are you willing to trust that Jesus is exactly who you need? Will you make room for the possibility, if you happen to have conflict between your beliefs and sensibilities and what Jesus says and does, that the one who needs to adjust is you and not him? Can you have faith enough in him that he is greater than your capacity to even fully understand? Will you yield to his authority and receive from him the gift that he has given you with humility? I have people in my life that I really love. I dearly love them. And I'm praying for them constantly because they have not come to this place of faith in their life. I mention them by name. I call out to God to please invade their thinking. Please help them to come to a place to understand what I've come to understand. I was saying to one of my relatives the other day who is in a very tough spot. Frankly, she's dying. I was sitting next to her and I was talking to her about the fear that is in her heart. She's so afraid to die. And I said to her, listen, I know that you have struggled with believing the Bible. And I know that you have struggled with knowing that God is who he says he is. And you've wrestled back and forth. I just want to tell you that I have studied this book for 50 years. And I have looked into it intently. And I've studied outside sources. And I have become convinced with every fiber of my being that God is exactly who the Bible says he is and that the Bible is giving us the roadmap, the way we can enter into death without fear. And I was able to speak to her and pray with her, and I'm very grateful for that moment that I had with her. She may pass away today, for all I know. I don't know. But I share all of that to say to you that I have a lot of loved ones who have not turned to Christ and received this gift. And there's a lot of reasons that I've been given. And I pray for them all the time. And I pray that a day will come when they fully understand the value of this indescribable gift. I love that God doesn't give up. His gift has been rejected time and time again. And yet the gift is offered today in the same way that it was offered the day that Jesus entered into this world. And I pray that one day my family and my friends who are lost will possess enough faith to trust him and believe in him. Church, we've been gifted with the Son of God. God wants you and I to have him. God wants you and I to have a relationship with him. And it is through Jesus. And there is no other way. Without this gift, there is no other way to relate to God. I sincerely pray to each and every person hearing this sermon today, if you haven't done it, you'll receive the gift that is too wonderful for words. If you already have accepted Christ as your Lord and Savior, I ask you to go back. Go back to the day that you found out and rejoice in the fact that you know Jesus Christ today. Reopen the gift and appreciate him again. Get away from your busy schedule for a little while and just worship him, right? Is he not worthy of the best that we can lift up? Father, thank you for Jesus. Thank you for the gift that is indescribable, that is beyond words, that is too wonderful. Thank you, Father, that you're willing to give him to me. And thank you every single day. My relationship with Jesus has a new dynamic in it. That's the gift that keeps on giving, isn't it? Every single day, he loves me. Every single day, I discover something that's different about the Lord. And guess what? When you and I get to go to heaven, I just believe that most of us will just stand there in amazement and gawk at God for about 10,000 years. And we'll say, look at that. Oh, look, wow, look at that. I think we'll just be overwhelmed by the glory and the majesty and the bigness of our God. Okay, I got to calm down, I know. But I want to call out to you who are struggling. And I want to beg you, if you have not received Christ as your Lord and Savior, let today be your day that you trust in him. You will not regret it. I promise you, based on experience, talk to any believer in this room who loves the Lord. They'll say, oh my goodness, it's everything. It is life. It is everything. I beg you to consider, believe, and receive this gift. And if you are a Christian and you're struggling with just telling others about it, if you're struggling with even inviting somebody about Christ, make this Christmas a different Christmas. Give somebody the gift of an invitation and offer to sit next to them. Bring them here. I'll spit and holler and shout for a little while at them. We'll sing together. But bring them into the house of God. Let's worship together. And let's maybe have an opportunity to give them the gospel of Jesus. Amen? That's worth something, brothers and sisters. It's the greatest thing that has ever happened. And there will never be anything better. Well, okay. So what do you do with this message? What are you going to do? Well, I pray that if you haven't received Christ, that this morning will be your day. You'll accept him. Will you close your eyes for me and bow your heads? I won't embarrass you. I won't come to you. But is there somebody who will say, here and now, I haven't done so, but here and now, I accept the gift that God has given in Jesus Christ. I need him. He's my Savior. I want him to be my Lord. I want to receive everything that comes with it. I lift my hand to acknowledge Jesus Christ as my Lord and Savior right here, right now. Thank you. Thank you so very much. Any others? Thank you very much. Amen. Praise the Lord. Right now, here, I receive Jesus Christ. Okay, thank you. You can put your hands down. Is there any Christian here who would say, Pastor Ken, I've struggled for a long time with even mentioning Jesus as somebody else, but I'm praying for God to help me, and I heard what God said to me through this, and I'm just asking you to pray for me this week as I do my best to do a better job at sharing Christ. Will you lift your hand up and say, God is speaking to me, and I want to do this. I want to be faithful to the Lord. Amen. Amen. Thank you for your faithfulness. Father, great is your faithfulness. You're a wonderful God. You gave us Jesus. We love you for it. We praise you, Lord. We thank you that you love us. We ask you, oh God, that as we leave here today, we will go out of here just knowing that we are blessed. We are gifted. We've been given you. I pray, Father, that you would especially bless those who acknowledge you as their Lord and Savior today. And that today, this won't just be an emotional moment or just going through the motions, but they sincerely say, I want Jesus in my life. And I receive him, I believe in him, and I want to begin my new life with him. I ask you to help them and bless them as they move forward, to find a Christian to talk to about this, so that they can begin their walk with you, their journey with you, to talk to a godly person. I ask you to bless us now as we leave here. Thank you for what you've done and what we've seen and sensed in you, in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you so much for coming today. If you'll let me get back to the door, you are dismissed. God bless you.